and it features Savi Sharma and Bulbul Sharma in conversation with Meghna Pant. Savi Sharma self-published her inspirational novel, Everyone Has a Story, which became India's fastest selling debut novel and was later acquired by Westland Publications. She went on to write two more romances, both instant bestsellers, and she is currently India's highest selling female author. Bulbul Sharma is an author and artist whose works are on display in Indian museums and private collections overseas. She has written 22 books, both for adults and children, including the recent Love and Learning Under the Magnolia, an old-fashioned romance set in the Himalayas. And our moderator for today, Meghna Pant, is an award-winning author, journalist, feminist, and speaker. She is the recipient of many writing prizes, including the Frank O'Connor International Award. Please join me in welcoming to the stage Savi Sharma, Bulbul Sharma, and Meghna Pant, presented by the Patrika Game Changer Series.
A very good morning, everybody. Great to see a fantastic turnout here today. You know, from time immemorial, love has formed the centerpiece of human life. Everything that we do is driven by love. Human survival, in fact, depends on us falling in love. A mother loving her child, a couple procreating, a son tending to his ailing father, a gay man adopting an orphan girl. The circle of love must always be complete. It's found in the tetrapods of Mumbai's Marine Drive, rain-lashed and unsteady, where most of the city's youth come to fall in love. It's found in the tombs of Delhi's Lodi Garden, where lovers lie under bougainvillea trees. But where does love stand in the world today? And how do contemporary authors give shape to the eternal lure of the romantic? And can these two authors convince this non-romance author, realistic author, who writes the antithesis of love, that true romance still exists? So welcome, Bulbul, Savi. It's really nice to be here. My name is Meghna Pant. I don't write romance. I don't even read romance, I have to confess. But I'm very interested and intrigued by what they're going to be speaking about, how romance and love coexist in the Me Too era. I'll speak to them for around 40 minutes and then throw it open to any questions that you may have in the audience. So let's get right to it, Savi, Bulbul. My first question is, how does love stand now in the Me Too era?
So I think we should start with the definition of love. For me, I believe love is to trust the person truly, completely, to surrender yourself, to surrender your soul to the person. It can be your brother, your sister, mother, father, your relatives, or a love interest, your boyfriend, girlfriend, or somebody you love, just anybody. So you need to surrender yourself completely, truly, and you have to trust them. You have to do things for them. It's not that you want something in return, but you just want to give yourself out because you love them, because you feel something for them, which is, you know, that bond, that connection, which is very strong and which makes you do things. That is love.
So how it stands today, to be very true, because of social media, there are some changes. Today people talk on social media and they just have e-meeting. And because of that, there are confusions. Because when you sit in front of a person, you can read their eyes, you can read their mind. And through eyes, you can look in their soul. But when you are on social media, you just read the words. You don't even know in which tone it has been said. So when you say I love you, so there are many emotions when you say I love you. Like very simple, if somebody gives you a very good coffee, you say thank you, I love you for this, right? But that is different than you saying I love you to your mother. Or if you are saying I love you to your friend or to somebody very special. So that can be there only and only when you are in front of each other and when you are talking with your eyes. So I believe because of that, it has changed. And today, people are kind of afraid to be vulnerable and they're afraid to express their feelings very strongly because they feel that, okay, what if the other person takes it differently? Because when you are in front of a person, you can express it very openly because you know, okay, how he or she is reacting to whatever you are speaking. And seeing their expressions and seeing how they are feeling, you can change what you want to say next. But when you are on social media, when you are chatting, so you don't know how that person is feeling. Is he or she blushing? Or is he or she angry or anxious or what? So because of that, it's changing. And because of that, there are certain issues which arrive. And I believe to take over them and to overcome them, you need to be there. And to be there and to communicate personally and have the touch.
Bulbul, what are your thoughts on how Me Too has changed the way we romance and fall in love?
Well, first of all, very good morning to all of you who are brave enough to come and listen to love at such an early hour in the morning. And what I'd like to say about Me Too is, of course, it's wonderful. It's very brave of the younger generation, because my generation actually swept everything under the carpet, however much harassment there was at work or family or wherever. So I congratulate all the young women of today who have the guts to stand up in public and say this happened to us. Yeah. And they're not ashamed. So bravo. But another thing is there are also hundreds of women in small towns, in rural areas, who have suffered equally, if not more, within the hands of their own family, their own community, and with no support from either. Of course, forget about the men, but even the women in the family, they have been tortured by, and they have no platform. So I would really like this Me Too movement to reach those people. Yeah. You know, they are there very quietly. They don't get their fame in the media. They don't even know about social media. So let's think about them also. And I'd also like, my book is not about romance at all, it's about literacy. It's about the love of learning, how a woman in a village learns how to read and write. There is a small love story which just crept in. You know, I've never written romance, but yahan pata nahi kya hua, these two fell in love. And totally, it's about class, because this man she falls in love with comes from he's a self-made man. He exports potato chips. And she comes from a royal family. So there's a lot of snobbish about not, you know, where did you go to school and where did you go to college, but they fall in love. So that's a parallel story, unlike Savi's, which are pure romantic and wonderful stories.
So let me gauge this audience for a second on your romance-o-meter. So how many of you still, after the Me Too movement, believe in, you know, true love and soulmates and love at first sight and true romance? Hands up.
Wow, look at that.
Okay, this is really heartening to see. It's quite a large number. Bravo, guys.
Very romantic.
You have not let cynicism get to you.
Saath saath aaye ho aap apne romantic ki alag alag aaye hain. To kya fayda fir kya maza aaya? Ikatthe baitho sab saath saath.
But I have to confess, of the people who didn't raise their hands, the non-romantics, under which category I think I also fall, because I have a very jaundiced viewpoint of romance. You know, I've been there, fallen in love, had my heart broken several times, broken several hearts in return, of course. Women power. No, I'm just joking. But, you know, for me, and I want to ask all of you also this, how many of you, once you see that happily ever after, you know, the couple walking into the sunset, either in a movie or reading it in a book, how many of you are like, but yaar, why is nobody talking after the after, about the after, right? Like, what happens after? What is the couple who've gotten together, they get married, we imagine that. They're squabbling over housework, they're squabbling over children, they're squabbling over in-laws. Why is nobody talking about that? And especially, you know, as an author, you anyway have a lot of angst inside you. So I keep wondering whenever I read, you know, hear about romance authors, I'm like, how are they reconciling the angst of the author with this kind of, you know, hope or escapism almost of the romantic? So how do they reconcile?
So I would like to start with that. Even though who haven't raised their hands, they are here listening to love in the air. So I believe somewhere inside they do believe in love. It's just that maybe they are afraid or maybe just they are looking for something more than what they have. So, but there is a hope. There's no hope. There is.
May I jump in here and ask, please raise your hands, those above 50, because I'm on the 50s side. And, you know, there is second chance. My book is all about second chance. So don't give up hope. 50 saal ke baad bhi dil dhadakta hai. You know, like she says, you can speak.
That's why they're here.
You can speak with your eyes, even if you've had a cataract operation. Uske baad bhi, you can speak.
And, you know, it does happen that, I think for everybody, when you have faced certain things in life, heartbreaks or anything, it does affect you. As far as an author is concerned, it's like you can express in words. So, and that's why you are always thinking. An author, a writer is always thinking. And because of that, he feels more deeply. And whatever the situation is, not necessarily your personal life, but even if you see your friend or anybody, and if you see them in certain situation, you'll think about it, you'll analyze it. That's what, you know, artists are always thinking and analyzing. So definitely it affects them more in certain ways, but they are trying to write certain things because possibly they see world in that way, because they see it in a positive way and they still feel that there is hope. Or maybe they are writing that because they believe that there should be such kind of fairy tales and such kind of stories and such kind of people. So they write it so that people can believe in it, they themselves can believe in it. And when you read something, when you write something, so you feel that, yes, there is kindness in the world and there is that love, there is that hope. And you try to put it outside. When you are reading, you feel that there is something inside you and you try to take it out. So maybe writers are trying to do that.
But what if you're undergoing, like, are you a heartbreaker or are you the one who has your heart broken?
Well, heartbreaker, I believe. But no, I don't believe in breaking hearts. But yeah, there are times when, you know, certain people express their feelings and you don't feel the same way. So it happens. But my heart is not yet broken. Like, and I'm a very hopeful kind of a girl, a very positive kind of girl. So even if it happens, I know that there is something good waiting for me.
But I mean, you know, there are a lot of romance authors. Like Ravinder was supposed to join us here today, but his mother's not well, unfortunately. You know, his romance journey, his writing into romance, started with a tragedy. He lost his fiancée. So, you know, I wonder when you're writing romance, if you have been on the other side of tragedy with either heartbreak or loss or anything else, then how do you communicate that kind of love and that kind of hope when you're writing romance? Like, I always wonder how they're reconciling their real life experience with what they're writing on paper.
I think that's the very human nature. Like, we are hurt and then we heal ourselves. Even when we get a scratch, with time it heals. So I think that's the human nature. We heal always. And when we are writing, when we are expressing, I think even Ravinder mentioned sometime that I wrote to take my pain out, but it really helped me in healing myself when I wrote about my story and Khushi's story. So it happens, when you express, you heal, because you take that pain out. And when the pain is out, there's space for healing, and you make that space to heal, to fill it with love and hope again. So it truly helps.
I believe as a writer, you very often use, I don't know, Ravinder did that. His book is very, it was his first book, and it's very raw, very vulnerable. But I know a lot of writers who use pain as a kind of writing. You know, it's a way of taking your story forward, even if it's a personal tragedy or something that happened to somebody you know. Writers are like magpies, you know, they're constantly stealing from other people's experiences, other people's lives. So in many ways, if something happens to you, maybe you can't write about it so well because you're so close to it. So I think Ravinder did a very brave thing to be able to write about the tragedy, and he's written it beautifully in a very simple way. So to me, another question I wanted to ask you girls in the audience, is it better to be a heartbreaker or have your heart broken? Now, I think that's something to explore.
I think I feel like a bit of both is good, because you have to experience everything in life, and having your heart broken has a special charm. Right. A lot of my writing has come from having my heart broken. So
as a writer, it's better to have your heart broken. If you're happy and cushy and all, then kya likhna? Kuch hai nahi likhne ko.
But you don't truly experience life.
Some experiences in life.
Then you have to.
So
write.
You know, I don't know how many of you here are aspiring authors. Who here? And please be candid. How many of you amongst the audience wants to get published at some point, or wants to write a book, or okay? And how many of you want to? Thank you. How many of you want to write romance? Oh my. Okay, Savi, you have all your aspirational authors here. So when you guys look at, say, authors, or you see us on podiums like this, or you look at, you know, romance authors. By the way, Savi has had one of the most incredible journeys. I've not seen this much since being an author, that she self-published her book, and then it did so well that she got published by the top authors, and she's the best-selling author in the country today. Her journey has been phenomenal.
Thank you so much, Meghna.
And I feel, especially as a female author, I know how difficult it is for female authors, because we get the lowest advances, we get the lowest publicity from our books, we get the lowest number of awards. So I know how difficult it is to be a female writer in India today. So hats off to your journey even more for proving everybody wrong.
Thank you, Meghna.
So, you know, the reason I was getting to this is because a lot of you see authors like us on podiums like this, or, you know, at literature festivals, and it all seems very glamorous and beautiful. But it's just the tip of the iceberg, because the actual 99% of the hard work that goes into being here today, nobody sees that. So one of the things I've noticed, especially for romance authors, which you also did, and I've mentioned you in my book here, is some of our other best-selling writers have also devised innovative ways and unique strategies to sell their books. And I think you did that as well. Very, very unique strategies.
Yeah.
So romance author Ravinder Singh launched a song by singer Shan to promote his book Like It Happened Yesterday. Savi Sharma posted inspirational quotes on Facebook for her debut novel, Everyone Has a Love Story, and packaged it as inspirational romance.
That's what it is.
Yeah.
Actually.
So it's very, and even I think Dojoy Datta had a lot of media campaigns and brand tie-ins where he splashed his marriage and engagement photos.
Yes.
So my question is, how much do you have to be the brand ambassador of romance?
So, you know, in today's world, it's clearly like out of sight is out of mind. Because earlier there were times when there was no social media. So people, readers used to know their authors only by their stories. They had the books, or maybe they would read some articles, some interviews in magazines and newspapers. But today they want to know their author's life. Today they don't buy the book and then try to know about the author. Today they'll first see how's the author. Does the author impresses us, and then they will go for the story, then they will buy the book.
So literally you're like, you have to be the brand ambassador of your book.
Yes, definitely. You need to be. It's not the brand ambassador of your book, but of your life. Like, you need to show who you truly are. Because I believe that even when you're writing, your personal life, at least your personal being is there in your books. Because whatever you truly believe in, you write in books. You won't create a world which you don't believe in. So if you are doing that, so you need to show who you are, not just in your books, but even in your real life. Whatever you are posting on your social media, whatever you are speaking out, you need to be very true, and you need to give that content. Like, as you said, that I shared inspirational quotes. So I believe, I always wanted to inspire people through my stories, and I believe that love is something which we all need to live in our life. So whatever you write about dreams, friendship, courage, healing, power, anything. There is love around us. It's surrounding us. So that's why I wrote an inspirational romance. So I had to give things out to people to let them know that what's there in my book and what is it that I want to share with them. Whatever I know in my life, whatever I am learning in my life, I wanted to share. So you have to be there as you are. And then only things work for you.
Yeah, that's one point of view, but I don't agree with that, because we've had hundreds of great writers who have never put their personal life, like J.D. Salinger, Mahasetha Devi, they've led very quiet lives, just totally committed to what they're writing about. Though it's changed now because, you know, with social media, marketing has become a great thing about writing. Everything has to be packaged. But writing has survived without that. So, and I hope it'll survive without that, because what concerns is your writing. And you as a writer, you're committed to what you're writing about. And not so much about who you are, what you dress, where you eat, what name of your dogs. And people ask you these questions, and it's not, doesn't really matter. It should matter what I'm writing and what my concerns are about my writing, about my subject, not about me so much. But it's happening now, it's changing. But I hope that both sides can exist. You know, the kind of writing where you know your writer, uske daant mein keeda hai ki nahi, everything you know about him. And at the same time, you read writers who you don't know anything about except what they write about and the world they create for you.
But what do you guys prefer as readers? Do you want to know your author very well or you don't? So who wants to know their authors very well? And who's like, no, I'd rather read the book. Okay, very interesting. So most people would rather read the book than get to know the author.
Right.
That's very interesting.
May I share an anecdote? I once introduced at a sort of social gathering, there was a famous writer sitting there. Of course, I won't take the name because then teamwork will send me to jail. And
that's not and a bad thing nowadays.
Yeah, publicity. So I introduced this writer to this person, and she came home and she told me, "Tumne badi galti ki. Ye itna ugly aadmi hai. Main iski kitabein saalon se pad rahi hoon, and now when I read his book, I you know see his face, and he's an obnoxious person. So you know sometimes it doesn't work. But of course, if you're as beautiful as Savi, then of course it works.
See, that's true. If you see the older generation, that is true. But today. If I want to give my personal example, today when readers read my book, they text me and they'll message me on Instagram, Facebook, and they'll ask me that, okay, ma'am, we have read this in your book and we really believe in it, but I have these questions, I have these queries. So when you personally connect with them, so you need to know your purpose. Like I, as I mentioned, that I want to inspire people. So if I want to inspire people, I can write something in my book. They'll read my story, they'll get some inspiration. But if you truly want to help them in life, you have to reach out to them. Because only when they'll ask you their personal questions. Yeah. Ma'am, you have mentioned this, that you know you can convince your parents like this. Yeah. But my parents react in this way. Then what should I do? Yeah. And when I answer them, then and then only they can move ahead in their life. They can get solutions in their life. Yeah. So for that case, I believe, at least for the youth, you need to be there.
But then, you know, I'm a writer. I'm not a counselor. You know, if they have problems, they can go to a counselor.
But you need to know what is
I'm only concerned about my writing. And if they like it, it's fine. If they don't, they can question
that's
my
writing.
That's
what I said, that you need to know your purpose. As I said, that my purpose is to inspire. So maybe your purpose is to tell a very good story. So you need to know your purpose. And according to your purpose, you need to package yourself and your life.
That's wonderful. There's a special book for every reader. Everybody, there's so many. I mean, that's the wonder of writing, isn't it? There's one, you may hate that book, but I will love it and I'll cherish it. So that's the wonder of writing.
I think we're seeing in India today, there's such a huge divide. Sure,
And this is what you guys should all buy, really.
Thank you. That's very kind.
And integration.
Yeah. Thank you. You know, my question is, do Indians know how to love? Now, how many of you in your lifetime, and let's be honest, have been properly wooed? Because that's one of the greatest parts to love, right? So how many of you can look back and you look at those Bollywood movies or whatever else, how many of you can truly say that you have been wooed the way a person deserves to be wooed? Great, fantastic. And how many they have? And how many of you have, you know, because we see this in India, that despite all the menage a trois and golden showers and all the concepts and jingoistic lingos that we hear today, most of the marriages are arranged, right? It's two families coming together according to their socio-economic compatibility. And it's not actually about the mental or emotional compatibility of a couple. So this brings me to the question that, do Indians really know how to love? Because most of the unions that we see of people are through practicality and not romance.
Well, this is beauty, may I answer that, of having an arranged marriage and falling in love with that person. I think that's really beautiful because a lot of people find it strange that, especially Western world, find it very strange that you have an arranged marriage with a person you don't know. But you know, there's a comfort level because your parents have arranged it, so it's basically it's a safe kind of situation. It's a different kind of family background, different education, different economic background, and then gradually you fall in love with each other. I think that's the most beautiful thing. My father-in-law never said I love you to my mother-in-law, but they were inseparable. And once she went into hospital, and I asked him, "Do you miss her?" And he says, "I do." I said, "Why didn't you tell her?" He says, "Kyun? Kehne ki kya zarurat hai?" You know, so that was just wonderful. They both understood that. But of course, I'm talking about another generation.
I think, but that's a very good point. You know, so my Nani ji, for example, she was one of the most loving people I've ever met. And she was the only grandparent I had. And she's never in her life told me that I love you or, you know, I miss you. None of that. She would never hug me also. But every time I came to Chandigarh to meet her, she would cook literally a feast, you know, deserving of a wedding. Or she would sit and oil my hair. You know, we'll sit under the sun on the charpai and she'll sit and give me from the heart. So they had different ways of showing love, right?
Yes. So we can't say that Indians don't know how to love. They have their own way.
They don't keep saying, "I love you too." I hate it. You know, everywhere you go, even do you go to a shop to buy toilet paper, the guy will say, "I love you too." I say, "Why?" You know? Then he looks at me and maybe he's been instructed by some multinational ki jo customer aayega usko I love you too bol dena. I hate it.
No, let's see, everybody has their own way of expressing love. So I truly believe that, you know, the song in Prem Ratan Dhan Payo, aaj unse mulaqat hai, kuch mathari wathari leke chale. So that was the way people used to express their love in olden days. Like, for example, my grandparents. So they won't express, but you know, they know that bhai usko gulab jamun pasand hai, to aaj gulab jamun leke jata hu. So that is the way they express their love. Yeah. So we do know how to love. But yeah, there are times when we are afraid to express. Because, and sometimes we feel that we love, what do we need to express? But the thing is that love is the thing which you need to express. Gussa to bada jata dete hai, to pyar kyun nahi? So jatane ki zarurat hai. Of course, "I love you" bol ke ya pura kamra phoolon se bhar ke, you know, balloon saja ke, that is not, it may be your kind, and if you feel that the other person, your partner likes that, do that. Balloon se bharo pura room, roses ka bouquet lao itta bada. But then if you feel that she is happy with just a rose or maybe her favorite chocolate, or, you know, he likes the shirt, so get the shirt and red color for him because he likes. So it's your way how you want to express, but just express love in whatever way. So Indians know how to love.
These small details, like Savi said, are so beautiful, you know, like she likes the rose, a particular rose, and you give her that. That's much more beautiful. Yeah.
You know, I feel like we've grown up on a very romance-free diet and our notions of love have, you mentioned a movie, our notions of love have come from Bollywood, which unfortunately in the 80s was all about, you know, pelvic thrusts and chest hair and stalking, which is so wrong on so many levels. But today we're seeing that even in movies, love is portrayed in a more realistic fashion. There's an actualization of feelings, there's agency that's exercised by both partners, there's actual compatibility that we're finally speaking about. So how much is Bollywood right now influencing notions of love in our country?
A lot. Because people tend to accept things which they see and they are very much inspired by it. So, you know, when Shah Rukh Khan does this, so every girl feels like their husband should do like this.
Hopefully not when he does Kiran and all that.
But they do want that, you know, this is how Shah Rukh Khan expresses, "Teri aankhon ki namkeen mastiyan." And you want to see that. So sometimes it helps in good way also. Like you see something in a movie and you feel that, okay, I should express my love in this way. But sometimes it raises the bar of expectations. And you know, the films are so much like, they are glamorized in such a way that people feel that, okay, hamari life bhi aise honi chahiye. But it's not always true. And because of that bar of expectations, there are problems in relationships and people do face that, okay, love is lacking in my life. But it's not actually true. It's just that you have raised an expectation bar that, okay, it should be like this. But it's not necessary. But yeah, there are now, I believe that even there are movies which are doing really well, like they are showing yeah. very realistic part of right. love where, you know, guys are just meeting, mandir ke piche, yeah, the way it used to, the way
so,
it
usually yeah. So which is your favorite movie about love and romance?
Well, there are many. I do love Shah Rukh Khan's movies when he sees in the eyes of the heroine. It's like beautiful. But I do love movies like Bareli Ki Barfi or Right Now Kahin Badhai Ho. So the kind of connection between Ayushman and his girlfriend was shown. It was really very powerful. And even his parents. So I'm like, I try to balance between both. Like I like both. There should be a balance. Like kabhi kabhi ek gulab hona chahiye to kabhi kabhi shayad ek pura, you know, a garden of roses.
Yeah.
So I like both.
Great. I think okay. it's changing. The new films, the Bollywood films, are actually quite realistic. You know, and they really deal with a lot of difficult issues in our society now, and it's totally changed from the time of running around the tree with, you know, flowers, and suddenly you'll see out of nowhere there'll be hundreds of flowers and they'll be transported to Srinagar. But now it's very realistic, and at the same time, even commercial cinema, which is very, I mean, does very well, like for Badri Ki Dulhania, I don't know how many, I mean, it's a wonderful way that it asserts a girl's right to work and lead an independent life. At the same time, she loves, you know, Badri. So I think that's a lovely movie.
Yeah, but there are also times when, you know, you are so, shown that a stalker, like he's stalking the girl, he's always behind her, but then suddenly the girl falls in love with him. So that really creates a negative impact. Like there are times when, you know, you invade the privacy of a person, you feel that main peeche peeche rahunga to ek din to maan hi jayegi. That's how you see in movies.
Yeah, so I think the issue of consent has been a very major thorn in our movies, you know, that they stalking is mistaken for love, which is very dangerous, and especially when it's
influences the youth. You are very obsessive about that person. It's not love.
Yeah.
So there are such movies which impact in negative way as well.
Yeah.
So I believe that you need to be very clear about your thoughts. And you need to know that you have to take the positives and not the negatives.
But do you think, like, as an author, your books have as much reach in influencing romantic notions as movies?
I think books, as of now, the readership has inclined. So it has declined.
Yeah.
So because of that, there are issues. Like, it's not reaching at that level. But yes, books do impact. Like, there are people who said that, you know, like me and my girlfriend had some problems. I read your book and I felt that I need to correct things and I need to communicate with her, and today we are together, we are happy. So it does happen. There are such messages I receive. So it's happening, but at a very lesser stage.
And there's a moral responsibility, I think, of the author
to
you know, communicate notions of love, I think, in a positive way.
True, because literature, words have the power to inspire people, to influence people. So when you have that power in your hand, you should use it wisely, and you should help making this world a better place.
Yeah, absolutely.
What I have against certain kind of movies, popular movies, is it encourages boys to behave in a very strange way. If you go to any holiday place, if you go to the hill station, they'll be perfectly normal traveling with you in the train, wherever. But when they reach there, they suddenly feel they have to behave like Shah Rukh Khan. They'll jump out of the train, they will start beating their chest. And once I got into a bit of an argument, and they said, to me, auntie ji, hum holiday mein aaye hain. And apparently, in Dilwale Dulhania, one of these popular movies, this is how he behaved. So they just were, they didn't want to behave like this, but they felt the peer group pressure. Ki bas jaise humne picture mein dekha, waise hi behave kar. And these are small town boys. So that is a scary thing, because not that they're bad guys, but they have been told this is the way to behave to woo a girl. And that's very frightening, and that needs to be corrected.
Absolutely. Thanks for making that point. You know, we were talking about, before we began the discussion, a lot of people don't know this, and this is again for all you aspiring authors out there, that most authors don't end up selling very many books, right? So only 1% of the books that are out there cross the 10,000 mark, which is what it takes to be a bestseller in India today. And less than 1% of authors in India today actually make a living out of writing. So 90% of the authors make less than 50,000 rupees a year. And these are shocking statistics.
So please go out and buy our books.
dukh bani dasta.
So, you know, for my book, I asked Durjoy Datta, who's again one of the top-selling authors in India today, about how much money even romance authors, because you guys are selling more than anybody else in India for a while now, almost 10, 20 years. So can romance authors afford to become full-time writers? And here's what he's written. He said, in India, no one except maybe Chetan and Amish can be full-time writers. In my opinion, Amish and Chetan are the only ones who can get by with enough earning potential for the next 10 years. Other best-selling writers like Preeti Shenoy, Raminder, and I can sustain right now, but it's possible that we might not earn enough if the market shifts. But for most authors, this is much less. But you were saying that, you know, you're the best-selling author in India today, and you've carved that niche for yourself where you can make a living out of writing. But would you advise other aspiring authors or published authors to become full-time authors and quit their jobs?
So there are two things in it. Number one, it's your content which matters, the story you are giving out to people. Because in today's world, it's most difficult to sell books, be it romance or any genre, because you have lots of content out there. You have Netflix, you have Amazon Prime. There's so many movies coming. So always people do tend to pick things which are easier to consume. Like when you are watching a Netflix movie, it just ended in 1 hour, 1 or 2 hours. And you're just sitting and watching it. But when you're reading, you have to give your complete dedication to it, your whole mind. So it's very difficult to sell today. And selling books is too difficult, be it any genre, truly. So I won't say that just quit and do, be a full-time writer or anything. And at the same time, it's about you. You need to decide that how much money is enough for you. Like there are people who are content in 5 lakhs, who are content in 3 lakhs, or some who wants like 50 lakhs, 1 CR. So I truly believe that what matters is how much is enough for you. So I truly have learned from my father and my grandfather that thode se mein bhi zindagi bahut khushi se guzarti, because money is essential, but it's not the most important thing in life. You just need it to have a roof on your head, to eat.
And meet your basic needs.
Yes.
Yeah.
So you need to know your requirements. And once you know that, okay, this much money is enough for me, yeah, then and then only you can decide, okay, I'm writing, yeah, this book, this is selling. Like, yeah, you don't just leave things at the beginning. Maybe if you're doing some job, write a book along with it, yeah, publish it and see how much you're earning. And if you feel this, I'm content in this, yeah, then you can leave the other things. But if you feel, no, I want a lavish home and, you know, a very luxurious lifestyle, then you'll have to work. You have
Don't
to do
be
other
a writer.
Things.
Then be a Aneta, Abhineta or cricketer.
Yeah, become a movie star or script writer in Bollywood. They earn a lot. Yeah. Yeah. Writing
even
is
Dujo
not
has written about, you know, that he writes for TV because, yeah, making money out of books is, yeah, not sustainable.
Yeah, initially his books, you know, you don't sell. So writing is not a money-making profession. At least, I don't think so. Unless, even if you're a successful writer like Savi. But you go into other professions. But it's better to, I would advise, to have another, like a day job to fall back on.
Definitely. So I'm going to ask my last question and then throw it open to the audience for any questions that you may have. What is your favorite romance book?
Love Story by Eric Segal. Yes, and The Notebook by Nicholas Sparks. Those are my favorite.
Mine is a book called All the Light We Cannot See. It's set, how many of you have read it? It's one of the best romantic stories set in the Second World War. If you haven't read it, please read it.
Fabulous. I think what we've learned from this discussion is that, you know, we all may love in different ways, who we love, why we love, when we love, does not really change, and therefore maybe love needs no definition, maybe it needs no understanding, but all we must believe in is that love still runs the world. So thank you so much, yes, Savi and Bulbul, for joining us here today.
Thank you. You can all say, I love you too.
So great, we'll take that, ladies.
Actually, I have the first question here. It's brought to you by the Patrick Egg Game Changer series. It's a question for Savi. Which is easier, writing a book or promoting a book?
Both are very difficult. When you're writing, you need to express things, whatever story you have, you need to express it in such a way that it can impress people. Because so much has been said about everything in life. If you're writing a love story, there are so many amazing stories. So to make it different, to express it in a better way, you need to work really, really hard. So it's definitely tough. And to sell is, I think it's more tough because, you know, there's so much out there. There's so much competition, not just with other authors, but the competition is with other platforms selling stories like Netflix, Amazon Prime, and movies, everything. So it's very tough. And in today's world, I think, especially in India, writing is declining. Reading is declining, so there are very few readers and there are very few people who want to read. So it's very tough, it's very difficult.
I think a writer must know one thing, that there are 82,000 books that are published in India every year. That means 20 books are coming out every day as we speak. And you're competing not just with those books, you're also competing with a backlist of 5 million books that exist in the world today. You're competing with the 10,000 movies that come out every year. You're competing with the 75,000 music albums. You're competing with Netflix and Amazon Prime and Taylor Swift and Taimur Khan. You're competing with everyone for their attention.
Very true.
And may I add, you're also competing with writers. I'm on a panel tomorrow. Guess what the age of my writers?
I feel too sorry for writers to compete
with
them.
It's 14, 9... and 11. I mean, can you imagine? These are writers and they have their own blog. They all publish. One of them is translated into French. I mean, I look at them and I say, oh God, I might as well go to sleep now.
I feel so sorry for writers that I never compete with them. I know how difficult it is, the journey. So yeah.
Everybody has their own place in life, isn't it?
There's always a reason. So we'll take that lady's question first because she's raised her hand for a long time.
Hello. Yeah, we've been hearing about love and love is in the air and all that. My only question to you is, you see, what is love after all? Now, my husband loves me, okay? He cares for me.
So
I love him also. Fine. Tomorrow if he goes out with another woman, would I love him?
No.
No. I'll take it to the court. Then where is love? One thing. Secondly, only at young age we fall in love. At my age, even if Amitabh Bachchan comes in front of me, I'll not fall in love. Why?
No.
Thirdly,
what about
One more thing. People say that mother's love is the purest form of love. What is mother's love? I love my child. What big deal? That's my child. I love this hand of mine, so it's my hand, so I love. In the same way, if I love my child, it's my child. If I love other children also, that is love. You are talking only of the romantic love. Young people's love, which is all hormonal, I think.
That's a different perspective for sure.
That will be another session and another book by Savi and me.
Okay, the lady in black here.
It doesn't send wrong vibes to the young people that falling in love is very important in life.
I think it
absolutely
is.
Absolutely not.
I think it's very important.
I think having a love for your passion. Yeah.
Know what love is.
They
do. Don't fall in love with your neighbor's son.
Why not? If he's good looking, why not? Yeah, I agree. I mean, there should be no restriction. I don't agree with you, ma'am. There should be no restrictions on love. You fall in love with whoever your heart desires. You don't fall in love with your head. You fall in love with your heart.
It's not working. So the question is actually about Ravinder's book. And I'm going to ask it to Savi because you've read it, right? So I read the book and I felt it was easy read and there was a lot of feeling in it. But all the feeling was coming from one person. It was just coming from the author. And though you call it was called a romance, there was no connection with the person who he loved. And there was hardly any interaction between him and Khushi. Right through the book, it was only about his thoughts and his feelings. And there was one or so tentative interaction, and then she dies, which is very sad. But the question is that love? Only what you feel. What about the relationship? What about the interactions? So I'm really sorry, Ravinder is not here, but to answer this question, but you tell me what you think. Thank you.
So, of course, Ravinder could answer that question very well, but I just feel that it's not about that there was no interaction or, you know, that it was one-sided. The thing is that sometimes when we express a story, whenever we are talking about something, we try to express our side of the story. So when a writer writes, it's about what's in his mind at that time, what he wants to depict. It's not that it was not love from her end or they were not discussing about it. It's just the story, the part of the story which he wanted to narrate in that book. So it, I think that's right, the thing
right.
here.
She's right. It's his take on it. Is his writer has his own view of how to express a relationship.
My question is to Savi ma'am, that you write about love, love, love and love. So from where did you get your notion of love and romance?
From people around me, people in my life, my friends, their boyfriends, their husbands, their fiancés.
So don't you have any boyfriend?
Not yet.
Okay.
Hello, Lata Sharma. You don't fall in or out of love. It's like cold. It happens. And if it happens, you can't help it. It just takes over. And your nose drips.
It's a feeling.
It's a feeling.
Oh, sweet.
And everything that happens in love, it happens. You really cannot help it. Take as much aspirin as you like and whatever you want. But you won't be cured of it. And even at this age, not Amitabh Bachchan particularly,
yeah.
but anybody in particular comes along and I'm again stricken with cold. Yeah. I'm stricken with
cold. Wow, give her a round of applause. Give her a round.
I can't help it. I really cannot help it.
Excellent. You yeah. should have been on stage with us.
I actually see clarity. The first question that you asked was, how can one love in this Me Too world? What is the relationship between a movement that is raised for sexual harassment and love? Is love sexual harassment? Is that what you're perpetuating?
No, what we're perpetuating is that for the first time in our country, there's a huge suspicion of both genders with each other. So men are looking at women very suspiciously, women are looking at men very suspiciously, and even things like office romances are now dying. They're on the deathbed, and I've heard this from many, many people because I was on the forefront of the Me Too movement. And I think it's a very sorry state of affairs, but also I've written an article about this for DNA, about love in the time of Me Too, that maybe it was a wake-up call for all of us to understand what love really means, and that it's not pelvic thrust and stalking and coming on to somebody and harassing them into submission. That is not love. Love is understanding and respect at its core. So how dare people try and demean it by sexually harassing a woman into trying to make them fall in love with him? How dare men use their power to induce romance in their miserable lives? So this is the whole notion of why Me Too is a death knell for romance if we continue this way.
Oh, she asked, shall I answer this? This lady asked, what is the difference between loving somebody and liking somebody? I think you need to do both. If you love somebody and you don't like him, it's not going to last very long. But if you like somebody and then fall in love with him, it's going to last for a long time.
Okay, there are two girls who are standing up and a guy over there. We haven't had any gentlemen speak. Let's give it to the gentleman there.
Come on, gentlemen.
Okay,
don't
these two
shy.
Gentlemen, you'll get your turn after. we need male perspective. Yeah.
Okay.
After
okay.
the lady.
Waving boy.
May I?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Okay. So, being a teenager, what I've noticed these days that we contradict a lot about the thoughts of love and what is love. So, what happens is when we fall in love, we go all fantasized and everything, and as soon as we go through breakup, we use cuss words and all, and this is amongst the teenager, like this is the most that I have noticed amongst the teenager, and we are becoming very pessimistic about love. So what can one do to change the opinions of others that love is still beautiful, it is pure, it has a soul? Like, if you can just say a few words of your opinions, just to change mind of us, of our minds, that love is optimism. It carries optimism.
I think it's the social media which is doing these things, but because you don't have a clarity of mind, you don't have a clarity of your thoughts, and so whatever you see, you just try to get inspiration from it, and you just accept those things that, okay, if this is written, like if when you are heartbroken, you have to go and drink, you have to smoke, and you know, you have to take a revenge from your ex. But you need to know that you love that person, even if he was not a good person, even if he or she didn't stand at par with your expectation, whatever it is, but you love them at some time. So you need to respect that love, and you need to stop doing such things because you love that person. Stop thinking about that person, but still think about your humanity, and that if you feel something for that person, even though whatever that person is, of course you might not love them then, you might not respect them, but there should be a humanity. And whenever you are doing something wrong to those person, to that person, even taking a revenge or whatever, you are hurting yourself. It's harming you. It's not harming that other person. So you need to know that love is very beautiful and love is pure. You see it everywhere. See it in real life. Your fathers, your parents, and your relatives, your friends. You need to know what you believe that love is, and don't let yourself influenced by people around you who says that this is how it should be, or the movies where you feel that, okay, if you're heartbroken, you need to do this, or if you're in love, you have to do this. It's not that. You should have your clarity.
Let's hear it from the guy. We need some male perspective. Yes.
Thank you, ma'am. Though I got a bit of the answer of my question from the questions asked by the people, but still, is love is evolving continuously, like it, in a different way? Like, it's losing its charm? Like, in the 90s, where the love should be so pure, so genuine, but nowadays, it's completely different. So what is your view on it? And also, in such a present era, where we hardly find love, the true love, then how to write in such a situation? Because you don't get the motivation. So there are two questions. So.
I'm sorry, I didn't get the last part of your question. How do you motivate yourself?
Motivate yourself to write about love when you don't see love around you that much.
Well, I think Savi is better to answer that because I just write. I don't think about writing about love or writing about whatever.
You'll give it to the lady in red.
Okay. Hello. I don't have a question, but I need to say something to Savi, ma'am. It took me like 3 years. I wanted to meet you for 3 years, so you really inspired me. And when I came here, I was so much in pain, feeling so lonely like that, and I was checking on Facebook, then I saw some of your quotes from the book. Then I commented on what you said one day, and you didn't reply. So I was so angry that you didn't reply back. After that, then I said, okay, if you can't write that, then I can also. So I started to write about my pain, how I feel every day. By that, then I became a writer myself, and I write. So I hated you before. Then I said, oh, this is not hatred, it is love. Out of love, then I became a writer, though before I don't know that I can write, but because of you, now I can write. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much.
Another gentleman, let's hear from him.
My question is, what strength exists in one-sided love?
That's real tragedy. That is the best book you can write when love is one-sided. Because then it's so much, it's Devdas. Don't forget.
Let's not romanticize Devdas, please. We'll have too many drunkards in our country.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, that girl who's been raising her hand for a very long time at the back. Yeah. And then I'll come to her because she's also been raising her hand for like 15 minutes now.
Youngest in our audience.
Hello, ma'am.
Yeah, she's the youngest. Looks like the youngest.
I believe that our generation, this millennial generation, has, I guess, confused love with lust and infatuation. So what's your take on that?
I think, as I said, that you need to have that clarity in your thoughts, and you need to know what is love. Love doesn't happen instantly. It's not that, you know, love at first sight.
we can have clarity in our thoughts. What about the other person?
Yeah, so that's the thing. Love happens with a duration. Maybe you are with a person for 5 years and then you find love in it. Or maybe it takes 15 years or just 5 months. So you need to know that at first sight, it's infatuation, it's a liking for that person, it's attraction. If it stands the test of time, then it's love.
My question is to Savi, ma'am. Ma'am, I read your books, all three of your books. The first, like she said, in your book, everyone has a story too. You narrated what happens after Happily Ever After. I really loved that concept and that way you showed fate meddling up in between everything happy. That concept was really very scary but great at the same time. So in your book, Everyone Has a Story Too, you showed Meera. You showed Meera as yourself. She has published one first book, Everyone Has a Story, and her second book she was going to write. But between, she got so much hardship, she cannot focus on her work. So is that inspired for your life?
Not exactly word to word, just like Meera's life. But yes, there were certain times in my life when I felt that I'm not able to write because fate has intervened in my life. And you know, there were things which I was going through and it really was there. But it's not my story exactly.
What's your name, please?
Asmi.
And how old are you?
I'm 15 years old.
How sweet.
Should you be reading love stories?
I was going to ask that and I'm like, I don't know if I should.
Shouldn't you be reading? Yeah.
We have another guy at the back. I'm going to take it from these two guys and think, then we'll have to wrap up. That guy and this guy.
Hello, ma'am.
Yeah. Oh, no, I was pointing to that guy. It's okay. Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah, so we have been saying that love just happens. Then even having some sort of affair in a relationship or even in a marriage can be justified. That I saw someone and I fell in love with her. So even that can be justified na, by this fact, by this saying that love just happens.
But you're already in love with someone, no. Apparently. No, if you're cheating on them, you're supposed to be in love with someone
That's
else.
That's attraction and infatuation.
Yeah. No, that is attraction. Initially, it is attraction. But after a certain amount of time, if we start spending time with her or something, just as a friendship and then it develops into love, then even that can be justified. Na, that love just happened. So
are you talking about cheating?
No, not exactly cheating.
So I've heard this very interesting thing that women are okay with their men cheating physically, but not emotionally. And it's the other way around for men. And I don't understand. So if a woman cheats physically on her man, he'll not tolerate it. But if she cheats emotionally, he will tolerate it. And I've never understood this because cheating is cheating, right? On whatever level it is. Anyway, the guy behind you.
Ma'am, every love story has an end at some point. And my question is, after that, does love remain?
So, and in what way? You mean to say that every love story, whichever it starts, it ends somewhere and people goes on?
Death do not us apart.
Not necessarily. So there are love is there till the end of your life.
Okay.
Okay, one last question and then we wrap up. Didn't you already speak?
Yeah, get a mic.
She's saying when somebody oohs and ahs at Salman Khan in movies, is that love?
Attraction.
Yeah, that's crowd hysteria. You do what your peer group is doing. And I think that's perfectly acceptable. I mean, I would ooh and ah at Salman Khan bare-chested.
Oh God, no.
Yeah.
I'm afraid we have
to. That's in every generation.
I'm afraid we have to finish. I'll suggest you take your question to the author signing area. Please join me in thanking Savi Sharma, Bulbul Sharma, and moderator Meghna Pant. This session was presented by the Patrika Game Changer series. And the authors will be signing. You probably know by now that the author signing tent is here at the back of the next at Front Lawn. You can go to Full Circle Bookstore, pick up a copy of their books, and take it over to the author signing area. They'll be there shortly. Thank you so much. The next session going on here at 12:30, so in 15 minutes, is Jan Nisar.